Hey, welcome back. My name is Dino, and in this mini lecture, we're going to be talking about isotypes. It's a form of information design innovation. As you see on the sign here with this gentleman holding up this little picture, it's the International System of Typographic Picture Education. I'll get into it more in a second. Isotypes have been considered as a picture language that became a type of visual writing. It was born in the 1920s in Vienna in Europe, and it was invented by Otto Neurath, who was a philosopher and sociologist with the Vienna Circle. Look at that handsome fella. Looks like my grandpa. It has roots in statistics. It began its name as the Vienna Method of Pictorial Statistics, and it helps to make statistical information and comparison legible to non-expert audiences through using pictures. So the thinking is the pictures are simple. People can add them together and see them, and it makes it more simple for them to understand. And eventually it became the idea or the name isotype, which again is the International System of Typographic Picture Education. There is a museum where some of the work was produced for the original isotypes. In terms of its innovations, so what it did specifically, it represented quantities as repeated pictograms of identical sizes. And instead of differences in size or volume to show like a quantity, it just basically repeated the pictograms. So as you see on the right in this home and factory weaving in England, you see the shape of the person is exactly the same. And it's just multiplied in multiple ways, and it's the colors are changed. And again, in terms of innovations, it helps to make visual statistics memorable. By looking at it, the number of pictograms that are depicted can be counted and compared to given numerical figures. As a result, it was far less dependent on written labels and contextual information than previous methods. So again, you could count the little men on the far left column, or the cattle that are red, or the pigs that are black, or the sheep that are blue. So you basically count them, look at the legend at the bottom, it can help you learn, read your way through it, again, without written labels for the most part. Hallmark revolutions and innovations was it's among the first standardized systems to represent social facts in pictures. You see two here, and I'll show each of them. This first one is a weekly earning of men and women in 1940. So you can see the various categories at the top: engineering, electrical engineering, etc., etc. And at the bottom, you see how they compare. Another sort of social issue that can be depicted is wages and unemployment. So here, low wages and unemployment as sources of poverty. So again, each of these individual figures, whether they're red, black, or green, are depicting various elements like wages and unemployment, comparing the years 1899 to 1936. And the legend at the bottom, red is regular work, black is unemployed, and green is other causes of unemployment. One of the best parts about isotypes is that it's a very elegant visual solution that largely remains unsurpassed. As you see on the left, it's a bunch of laborers. You can see, again, it's like these people who are the same size, and what's the only difference is the icon within them. So like on the, not the upper left one, but say the second one from the upper left, he has a gear, so the person's most likely an engineer. The people in the middle on the left, they have this kind of measuring device. They're most likely some kind of mathematician, et cetera, et cetera. And again, you see the one on the right with population born abroad. Again, you can compare the numbers based on the little figures that are depicted, green and red, comparing the U.S. and Great Britain. However, it is not as infinite abilities to do things. It has some limitations that Neurath talks about. If you have emotional content, they seem unable to sort of convey that. And he wanted to make it very clear that it's a supplement to rather than a replacement for natural languages. What he's basically saying is that I think there's a limit to how much they can communicate, and spoken word, written word is just more precise and can do more things. Something that I've added is the idea that it's changing, and it's tethered to changing physical objects. As you see in the next slide, on the upper right, you can see a telephone. On the bottom, third from the bottom right, you see a typewriter. These are things that, you know, in future generations, the sign for a telephone or the sign for a typewriter, although they depict what these were back in those times, you're going to have over time, as these physical objects, as phones change from rotary phones to smartphones, or moving away from typewriters altogether into computers, some of these symbols just don't make as much sense. So that's a limitation for them as the physical world changes. One of the things that is particularly useful for the present day is that isotypes are a precursor of current visual icon systems. So for example, if you go to an airport or you look at a sign on a road or you look on a toilet door, they have very similar things that are basically isotypes. So on these four things that you see here, different colors, slightly different shapes, they're all pretty easily understandable icons for an airplane. Here are some other ones that Neurath, where they were developed based on the isotype system. You can see on the middle left, person reading, second from the left, someone putting on diapers, et cetera, et cetera. So you can see how these different these systems can convey things that are really easy to understand. Sometimes they're a little bit more complex. One of the things, again, like in terms of today, we have current visual icons and they take on a thing called skeuomorphism. Great word. Skeuomorphism is basically the definition is derivative objects that retain ornamental design cues, like attributes, from structures that were necessary in the original. I'll give you an example. You'll have a better idea of what this means. They're mainly used to make something that's new feel familiar in an effort to speed understanding and acclimation. So sometimes we create new things. People are like, I don't know what that is. Can you help me? So for an example, if you have a desktop computer or a phone and you have a calendar in it, that's a software calendar, what they'll do is have the icon look like the analog version of it. So a software calendar, instead of it just being digital, it looks like a paper desk calendar. So people go, oh, I know what that icon means. An example right here is the idea of iBooks. It's the icon on the iPhone or iPad or MacBook or desktop computer. In the old days, the icon looked very much like a book. Like on the left, you can see the wood behind it. You can see the paper and the pages. The one on the second from the top left looks very similar. But as you go over time, it becomes more basic, more easily replicable in vector design programs like the ones on the right, on the far right at the top. It's very simple. So my friends, that was isotypes. Thank you, Mr. Otto Neurath, my favorite grandpa who worked in designing and isotypes. Have a great day. Thanks for watching.